That's some perspectives coming from Standard Chartered out there. Now let's shift focus to earnings back again and shift let's go across to Bangalore where Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, CMD at Biocon, is joining us right now. Ma'am, thank you so much for joining us on this leg of the show. And firstly, congratulations as well regarding the GE Capital deal. Break it up for us. What does it actually mean for Syngene in terms of benefits?
Well, first and foremost, the GE Capital investment in Syngene establishes a base valuation. We believe that, we need to unlock the true value that Syngene basically commands, and this was not coming through in terms of the overall valuation of Biocon. And by doing this, we are basically now unlocking at least a base level valuation in Syngene ahead of going to the market. Apart from that, I think I also want to emphasize the fact that, there were many suitors for taking this stake in Syngene. And, why GE? Because I think GE goes beyond just a financial stake. I think what GE brings more than what other...
All right, I think we just having some kind of an audio problem then. We'll just try and just rectify that. But you will hear Kiran actually talk about the fact that how it's actually gone ahead and being a beneficial deal for Syngene that establishes a base valuation. Michelle, I would guess you're back with us on the line. Apologies for that line connection. That was a little bit of a disruption there. Please go ahead. You were explaining as to how why you've gone ahead and selected GE Capital.
Yes, I think GE goes beyond just having a financial stake in Syngene. I think GE brings a lot of leading-edge expertise in life science technologies, which we believe that Syngene can benefit from in terms of further enhancing its value-added and differentiated research services. So we think this is a very important investment and an inflection point, both for Biocon and for Syngene, ahead of taking Syngene to the capital markets.
Fair enough. Let's also talk about how the quarter has actually panned out for Biocon, because it's been a good performance this time around. Take us through the key highlights.
Well, at a group level, we've delivered a 23% year-on-year revenue growth. At a EBITDA and PAT level, we have grown 8 to 9%. Broken down segment-wise, the biopharma business has grown 21%. Branded formulations has been a huge growth driver for our group. It's grown at 45% year-on-year. And our research services business continues its very strong growth momentum, delivering 40% year-on-year growth. So as you say, overall, we've actually grown all our verticals very well. And I think the fact that despite increased R&D spends, which have gone up 57%, despite our increasing power costs, our increasing personnel costs, and increasing import costs, I think we have done extremely well to deliver this kind of growth that we have done for the first half of this fiscal.
Ma'am, we've been talking to a whole bunch of analysts regarding Biocon over the last couple of months itself, and one factor which they've been talking about has been the licensing income part of it. In your own sense, what kind of an outlook can you actually share with us in terms of licensing income going forward from here on?
Well, as you know, licensing income is an event-based kind of an event-based kind of activity, and therefore we cannot really predict when closure happens on any of our licensing deals. Having said that, we have a very rich pipeline of licensable assets. I did make a statement that we are in advanced stages of finalizing our development licensing deal with a large pharma for our oral insulin program, or IN-105, but I must caution you there that this is going to be a back-ended licensing deal. So, don't expect huge licensing fees up front. Having said that, we are also looking at licensing our anti-CD6 molecule, itolizumab, which will be in the form of an upfront licensing deal. And then we have got also another very interesting molecule, the BVX20 molecule, which will also have probably some interesting upfront licensing income. So overall, licensing income continues to remain a very important part of our business. But having said that, I think you should see this happening over a 1 to 3 year time horizon. So that's what it's all about in terms of novel programs. In terms of our biosimilars program, as you know, it's been partnered with Mylan, and that is making good progress. And in terms of our insulins portfolio, we are engaging with several new regional partners, and we are also engaging with potential partners for developed markets, and you can watch this space. Having said that, I think insulins is also a very important segment for us. We are gaining a lot of traction in various emerging markets, especially LATAM, Middle East, North Africa, and Southeast Asia, as well as some parts of Eastern Europe. So you can, we are very confident that insulins is going to be a big play for Biocon going forward. And this has been further endorsed by the fact that we are making a $200 million investment for capacity expansion in Malaysia.
Right. Pam, the other thing that analysts keep telling us, the fact that regarding the European part itself, is a biosimilar Rh insulin update. Is there anything that you can probably share with us right now? Because what we understand, that's the other big avenue for Biocon itself.
Sure. Well, you know, we have just announced very positive data from our phase 3 European clinical trial for our recombinant human insulin, which has shown safety and efficacy comparability with innovator products. And of course, we are now awaiting 1 year immunogenicity data, which will come out later next year. So once that happens, we will be filing for a marketing authorization for Europe, and it will enable other registrations in other parts of the world.
Ma'am, you touched upon branded formulation business also in your previous reply. Can you elaborate a little bit in terms of outlook as to how you're reading and what's the outlook that you're working with in terms of estimates for that particular business?
Well, you know, this is a business that's growing at 40%+ year on year. And we believe that this is going to be a 500 crore segment for us within the next two fiscals. So I think this is something which we are very focused on, we are very committed to. This is going to be a 1,000 crore vertical for us over the next five fiscals. So we are very, very gung-ho about this particular branded formulations vertical, because it does build very strong brand value for Biocon and recognition of our marketing capabilities.
Ma'am, I also wanted to ask you regarding R&D costs, as to what kind of estimates are we working with going forward from here on, from an FY13 point of view? How do you see that panning out?
Well, you know, analysts have always expressed concern about increasing R&D spends, but I think I just want to make a comment here saying that I don't consider this as an expenditure. It is a very important investment for Biocon. R&D is an integral part of our business. It's an investment that will deliver exponential growth for us in the future. It is something that is critical to our business. And it is something that will increase, because as our programs enter the clinic, R&D spends will increase. So the increase actually is a reflection of the advancing programs. So once products make it into the clinic, it is reflective of the advancement of these programs. Unfortunately, clinical trials are expensive, so R&D spends will increase. But having said that, we have business traction that will allow us to afford spending and advancing our programs. And I think that's the way you have to look at Biocon's overall business model in context of the fact that whilst R&D spend is increasing, so is our business. And that's how we are able to sustain increasing R&D spends.
Fair enough, ma'am. In fact, just to get a final thought in terms of your outlook for FY30, not to get into specific guidance as such, but how do you see business panning out for FY30 at Biocon? And also, if you can touch a little bit as far as domestic markets are concerned and the international markets.
Well, you know, we expect to keep up this growth momentum that you have seen in the first half. And as far as our domestic market, foray is concerned, it's doing very well. I'm sure we will be able to maintain this high rate of growth. As far as overseas markets are concerned, we are seeing emerging markets play out very well for us, and so is U.S. The U.S. is being strongly driven by sales coming from our tacrolimus immunosuppressant program, as well as from our fidoxomicin supplies to Optimer. So I think these are driving our good high-value margin sales into the U.S. And apart from that, we do have our historic bread-and-butter business coming from statins and other immunosuppressants. So overall, I think we are seeing some good, steady business being driven in across all markets.
All right, ma'am, we leave it there. Thank you so much for joining us and getting us that perspective as to how the quarter has been and what the outlook looks like at Biocon. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, the management at Biocon, talking to us and giving us a bunch of perspective in terms of the road ahead. So the company stock's been holding on decently, 1.5% up move.